Still to come, a rough guide in Dublin. On day two, he can't lose but win.
Is this street supposed to be the widest street in Europe, isn't it?
Yeah, they say over here it's the widest in Europe, but whether it's true or not, I don't know.
Europe, isn't it?
Yeah, they say over here it's the widest in Europe, but whether it's true or not, I don't know.
Okay, so where is O Connell Street? Up there.
Straight up there, that's it.
The GPO building was actually built by the Brits in the 1800s. But in 1916, it was used by the insurgent forces as a headquarters. The leader of the uprising, Patrick Pearse, actually read out the proclamation of the Republic from the steps over there, and you can see a bit of the text in the front of the building. The inside of the place was then destroyed by fire in the fighting that followed. It's now such a potent symbol of nationalism that when people want to hold demonstrations and political rallies here, they have them here rather than at the Doyle.
I started doing street art about 5 years ago. I seen a chap doing it one day, and ever since I've been doing it on O'Connell Street.
Have you seen lots of changes in O'Connell Street since you started doing this? Because everyone tells us that it's rapidly moved into this kind of fast food, you know, rubbishy type of place.
Yeah, I have seen a good few changes actually with the shops. There are like fast food places opening up, you know, harbour fronts on them, you know, modern stuff and that, you know.
Well, if the GPO is the seat of revolution for Irish politics, this is the seat of revolution for Irish fast food. Abracababra, it's called. There are now 10 of these in Ireland, and 1 million kebabs are sold every year, so Ireland is becoming a nation of kebab eaters. Right, I'll have a doner kebab, I think, please. Pre-wrapped. Yep. Great. Okay, look at this, chaps. Thank you. Europe's first fast food kebab. Available instantly.
Now the dogs are biting me ankles now, and it's rarely understood that wherever you're going to find green mare, the young ones will stop and stare. All in the mucky mud. All in the mucky mud. All in the mucky, 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 mucky mud. All in the mucky, 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 mucky mud. The mucky, 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 mucky mud.
Check it out.
The man says things of the night, sunshine and holidays, postcards to write, budding trees, autumn leaves, a snowflake or two, all kinds of everything remind me of you.
Yes, I was going over the Cork and Kerry mountains. Then produce my
This has always been a musical city, but if you visit Dublin now, music is virtually an epidemic. Everyone's in a band, and those people who aren't in a band are the ones who manage a band, or write about a band, or record a band. They've got their best friend in a band, their brother or their sister. Walk down a street, find an attic, a garage or a warehouse, and chances are you'll find a band lurking inside somewhere.
Unemployment in Ireland, so all the kind of kids are going out instead of like sitting at home with no jobs, going out and trying to spend, get as much money as they can, buy a guitar and, you know, play and, you know, just learn music. And then I think another thing obviously is U2 being the biggest band in the world, and they kind of see them and think, well, you know, everybody's got a chance. They started off in a garage, so why can't we? So I think it's, you know.
Power of Dreams, you reckon you're the youngest band in Dublin?
I'd say so, yeah, definitely. I'm doing the circuit anyway tomorrow, playing gigs.
So how old are you?
I'm 16. The drummer brother's 14. Guitarist and bass, 16.
Is it difficult in Dublin for a young band to get started?
To get gear, it is. Like, generally it is. Like, you get trouble with neighbours and stuff like that, practicing before you can actually get into a place like this, yeah.
Where would you find bands? Where would you pick up this kind of buzz?
You just have to walk around to any bar, any pub. There's quite a few venues in Dublin. Look up, buy the In Dublin magazine, read the gig guide, it's all there for you. Go to the Pink Elephant nightclub and you'll see every musician swilling pints over the bar. You'll find out what's going on. And then there's a few different concerts that are great. On a Friday night, there's a band called the Flat Cowboys, and they play at midnight on a Friday. And there's about, like, say, six of them in the band, but by when midnight's over, it's about 20 local musicians up there playing, and every week they have guest musicians. They've had Shane McGowan and all kinds of people, so it's
so
pretty exciting.
Where does that happen?
That takes place in the Olympic Ballroom.
The opening sentence of James Joyce's last novel, Finnegan's Wake, captures beautifully the spectacular location of Dublin, with its bay stretching from Killiney through the city and right out again to the promontory of Howth. And the sentence goes, "River run past Eve and Adams, from swerve of shore to bend of bay, brings us by a commodious vicus of recirculation back to Howth Castle and environs." One of the reasons why there was so much great literature produced in this city was the special attitude of the Irish people towards language. A large majority of the Irish people, even in the last century, continued to speak and think in the Irish language. And it's only within the last 150 years that English has totally taken over. James Joyce refers to this grating of one habit of thought and expression against another, for he took over the language of Milton and Shakespeare, the most prized possession of the British people, smashed it into unrecognizable fragments, reassembled it in a totally new language, and as he said, he declared in Finnegan's Wake that he would wipe Ali English spooker, multifoniaxically spooking, off the face of the earth. In fact, James Joyce's experiments in language with Finnegan's Wake could justifiably be seen as the equivalent in language of scratch music. Whatever that is.
Before everyone whistles up by 2-1 odds on. And they're off. A night's drinking to be won. The excitement. Galloping with the reins. The whip beats into the horse's shanks. Whipping, whipping, whipping. And leaping as far as they can. Stretching, stretching. 2 furlongs to go and we're still in with a chance. A chance. Race, race, race. The horse's mouth foaming. Straining at the bit. Reaching, stretching. The whip beating, tearing, the sting, the pain, muscles pulsing, groping frenzied for the lion. Whip beating, reins tugging, and it's over. It's over. We're unplaced, and it's over.
Horse racing is an obsession in Ireland, and this is the high temple of Irish flat racing, the Curragh. Not so much a race course as a state within a state, where the thoroughbred racer is undisputed king. Around here, almost every building has a horsey connection. Stud farms, training stables, horse hospitals and other support services. Shergar vanished from a stud farm just around the corner. And the whole shebang comes down to maybe 3 minutes of frantic activity when some very tiny men indeed push, coax and bully half a ton of finely tuned horse flesh past the winning post. Secret of success?
Dedication, light, and be mean like on the racetrack. You don't give anyone an inch and hopefully get there in front of everyone else.
What about talent? Does that come into it?
Ah, you have to have a bit of talent. You know, you have to be part of the horse when you're on them. Love horses.
Ups and you look up the index that gives you a horse, you go to its previous run, we get the videos of each day's racing and you go through those as well to see whether horse do you think is going to improve on its previous run or not. But that's what's meant to what it's all down to. And then there's different weight counts as lengths, you know, you balance it all out. It's not that hard.
Don't back English horses.
What do you mean? Are you just out of patriotism?
Yeah.
Really?
Don't back English horses.
That doesn't sound like very good business practice, though, does it?
No. You come out on top if you don't back them, because none of them get beat.
Don't listen to them. We were told that the last winner wouldn't like the ground, and he wouldn't act on the ground. What's he? He's only won two legs. You can't listen to people. If you listen to the tips every day and you're a punter, you'd go skint.
People say that betting is a mug's game.
No, it's not. Damn mugs to say that.
Really? So in your experience, you've actually come out on top, have you?
Yeah.
What do you think of punters?
Look at our livelihood from them, they're great chaps, great fellas. But no, there's some of them you have to watch for. Some of them are very, very shrewd. And whenever they back a horse, it usually runs well. They're professionals, you know.
Yeah, but do you think some punters are just mugs? They keep coming back and
for no, more? No, you get every punter is going to back a winner. He can't go keep on losing and losing and losing. The law of averages just doesn't allow you. He's going to back a winner before too long.
Glamour's at home, but when you come to the races, that's where it all begins, you know. Brilliant at the races, you know, riding in races and just brilliant.
Well, no, I'm afraid I haven't actually decided to give up the fast pace of the city for the delights of a country rural life.
Going to start now.
Our Godfrey will not be pleased.
This actually is, in fact, something called the Viking Adventure. It's built to the exact specifications of a real Viking village which was discovered on this spot 14 years ago.
Give it to me, you're no good.
Always complain,
will you go home?
Now, I must admit, I wasn't actually crazy about the idea of coming down here, but the whole thing is really authentic.
Apart from the belt, you're very busy now.
The one thing I can't show you is the incredible smells. Pigs, stew, lots of other really disgusting things like sewers. The 11 people who work here playing out the roles of the Vikings have 6 weeks very intensive training as to how to be a really realistic Viking, and you try and catch them out on anything. What's all the makeup that you have on your face?
It's on my face.
There's all those black marks.
Oh,
what's that?
It's dirty, is it?
Yeah. Dirt.
It's dirty.
Oh, how often do you have baths here? How often do you wash?
I don't understand the words you're saying.
With water, you take water and you wash.
Oh, the waterfront. Yes. The waterfront just out there. Sometimes you go into the waterfront.
How often?
When I'm told to go by my mother, sometimes.
What is this strange jewellery you wear on your face? This around your eyes.
These are called glasses.
I've never seen this before and I've travelled far.
Out of sight to most casual visitors to Dublin is another world of horses. Here on the Ballyfermot estate, these animals wandering free may seem unloved and uncared for, but that's not the case.
It's like a dog, much bigger. You can have plenty of time with them and great fun and everything else with them.
Yeah, but kids of your age are usually out. I mean, look, you're wearing a football jersey. Why aren't you out playing football or getting ready, you know, sort of for messing around with motorbikes or things like that?
They mostly kind of keeps you out of trouble, like.